Welcome back to Smack Talk with Shawn Ray and Dave Palumbo, your host, of course. Welcome back, Shawn, and congratulations on your new job over there at Muscle and Fitness and Flex. I see the little back. Your backdrop changes every time we talk.
Listen, man, I don't let the grass grow. I'm staying busy. I'm a hustler.
Now, what's your role over there? I know you've been brought on to help him promote the Olympia. Obviously, we have our mutual friend Dan Solomon helped facilitate that. What's your official role over there?
Well, I'm one of the senior analysts. I mean, in the digital age, man, I mean, it seems like the magazines are struggling to get content. So I do submit articles for Muscle and Fitness. I am the man on the street, going to all the bodybuilding shows, getting interviews. I'm networking with some of the sponsors as well, but most importantly, just bringing the news, reporting the stories, providing content like I've always done with all the other media outlets. And I got my career started with Joe Weider back in 1987 at Muscle Fitness and Flex. And, I then moved on to Robert Kennedy. I worked for him for 2 years at Muscle Mag International, and I worked with Steve Bleckman for 10 years at Muscular Development. I had a small run with another media outlet, and now I'm here doing what I do best. This is where I come from. I started my career with ESPN, if you remember, with Liz Wick.
Yeah.
So I'm doing more of the same in terms of just bringing the news and information because I am the man on the street, and we're in a global industry right now with the NPC worldwide.
Shawn, when you did that show back in the day on ESPN with that workout show, I think it was called Flex, wasn't it, or something like that?
Yeah, Flex Magazine Workout. And we had ESPN, they had a news section with American Muscle with Liz Wick.
Yeah. I liked that show, the Flex Magazine show. How did that come about? What was the gig with that thing?
Well, the premise was, Liz Wick was pretty much highlighting bodybuilding. Remember, there was Muscle Sport USA also. So yeah. It was a really good time to be a bodybuilder because the other parts of the country got to know who we were through ESPN. And it wasn't about... size. It was about information. I learned about Eddie Robinson through American Muscle and Liz Wick. And of course, you found out about Dennis Newman. And it was covering the scene, kind of like the roving magazine. But what we found is with the World Wide Web, we can hit a wider market. There's less cost. There's fewer field hands. And that's where I actually met Robin Chang working with Liz Wick as well.
Really?
And like everything, the evolution of our sport kind of fizzled out and then the internet took over.
Shawn, how did you wind up, Boyer Co. wind up on that show with you?
So Boyer Co., he's a local guy, first of all, and he worked with Flex Magazine, and he also worked with Flex Equipment, I should say, but he also worked with Body Masters. Body Masters supplied the gym equipment that we were training on the Flex Magazine workout.
Gotcha. So that was the time. I always wondered how Boyer Co. got into that show. I always wanted to find out, so now I quenched
my... He also worked out at the gym I was training at, Metrix, over here. So it was kind of like a one-stop shop. Once the concept was conceived by Joe and, of course, John Trietta from Flex Magazine Workout.
Yeah.
John Trietta was Flex Magazine Workout. Once that was conceived, we were kind of a package deal.
Gotcha. Cool. All right, let's talk about the Olympia a little bit. Obviously, we saw Shawn Rhoden on stage at the Pittsburgh Pro. Wasn't in the best shape of his life, obviously. Looks like he just really started to get into training again and preparing for the Olympia. Now, you were a guy who really didn't train all year either toward the end of your career, and you kind of just, got ready the last 20 weeks or so.
Well, let me draw the distinction. You're right. I took my time off, Dave, from September when the work was done to January. So I had this 3 month period where I can kind of cruise. I mean, taking time off doesn't mean not going to the gym or not eating good. Mm-hmm. It just means taking your foot off the gas, right? But when January came, it's time to get busy because I'm making appearances throughout the year.
Sure.
And a large part of my income was from actually making public appearances and posing. What Shawn did, I did one time. I had to fill in for Kevin Lavroni. And if you surf the net, Dave, you'll do this. Shawn Ray fact. It'll come up. I was called on a 2 week notice to fill in for Kevin Lavroni. I was kicking and screaming. And I had to go because back then Weider had us under contract. Yeah. It was like I was the last resort and I was the only one. And I went and there's like two pictures floating around that I filled in. It never happened again.
It actually did. It did because you and I guest posed once for Tanya Knight's husband. Remember?
Great.
In Missouri, you said you told me also you weren't in shape. You weren't expected to do that. They got you last minute.
Yeah, I mean, but my expectations of what I look like are a lot different than others. I mean, me being fat and out of shape in my mind is a lot different than others, but this was a whole nother story. Like, at any given time, this guy could have pulled the president aside on Friday after the VIP dinner or whenever he got his little envelope with money in it and said, hey, you make the call, Jim. Come take a look at me here in the bathroom. Come backstage and look at me. Somebody look at me before I go out there.
There also wasn't an internet back then, so no one saw you. You know what I mean? Except the people in the audience.
Yeah, nobody saw my stuff.
Yeah.
So I got away with it once. I saw a couple of fat pictures of me, and thank God I never let that happen again. And actually, Dave, that was the year I got second in the Olympia. So can Shawn bounce back? He could, but I didn't look like that at that stage. Like, I don't know anybody that looked like that at that stage.
Right.
So whatever he's going to do, whatever protocol he's going to do, it will probably be more extreme and harder than anything else to catch up and make up the ground, which becomes dangerous.
All right, now the question is, I don't doubt that he's going to be in shape for the Olympia, but the question is, some people were actually offended by how he looked, and they said it wasn't professional for Mr. Olympia to show. Did you believe that too?
Absolutely. Dude, that was a total embarrassment. Listen, there's no excuse for that. You didn't come out of the hospital. Mm-hmm. Just being off and, hey, I don't start until May, then you know what? Take responsibility and keep your clothes on. At some point, you got to keep your clothes on and say no to some things. If I was a kid in the audience, my dad brings me and I'm going to see Mr. Olympia and I'm jacked up and this guy walks out? Come on. I mean, this is not the first time this has happened. I do know for 100% certainty in November, Shawn was with me in China. Mm-hmm. Shawn told the promoter he was sick. 2 weeks prior, I guess he made an appearance in the Philippines, looked like crap, got a little backlash. But when he wound up in China, he didn't pose and he kept the deposit.
Wow.
And he had the business class plane ticket, and he had the 2-day vacation to sit in the front row and watch a bodybuilding show. And never once did it become in his economy to speak at the microphone and say, hey, guys, I know I'm on the poster and I know you expected me to pose, but I got a little bug and I'm sick and I'm not going to pose. That didn't even come across.
Right.
So in this scenario, had Shawn gone to the mic, and I don't know that he didn't, all I saw was what he said after the fact, but what do you go to the microphone and say, hey guys, I'm sorry I look like shit, but come September when it matters, I'm going to be, nobody wants to hear that. Keep your clothes on. Hmm. So as an athlete, I was offended because I know what it means to go and take your clothes off in front of your fans. Not only that, but I had this conversation, Dave, when Dallas McCarver, 3 weeks out from the Arnold Classic, I was pissed off.
Right.
Because he showed up not shaved, not tan, not professional, not doing what he's supposed to, and he's doing it for Jim Mannion of all people. So as a pro, I was pissed off because you're wasting the guy's time. Now, Dallas bounced back. He had muscle, he was fat, and he was bloated, but we know how that thing ended because you push harder and harder, and you put that stress on yourself. Things can happen. I don't want to see anything happen to Shawn Rhoden. I mean, but the lesson he taught us right now was if you're fat and you're not training, say no.
Yeah. Now, as a professional athlete, as someone who's seen a lot of bodybuilders get in shape, not get in shape, even if Shawn gets in shape for the Olympia, do you think that this is a problem for him? Because maybe he won't be able to get back to what he was. He certainly won't be able to go beyond what he was, I would say.
Yeah, I think it's a problem in the sense of damage control. Listen, he sounds like he doesn't care about his image anyways. He's really crystal clear that, look, I'm Jamaican. I come from a skinny, fat family. It is what it is. I mean, there's no remorse in what happened. It wasn't an accident that he showed up and posed fat and out of shape, okay? To me, that was a deliberate act because at any given time, he could have said no. He wouldn't have been suspended. He wouldn't have been fined.
Right.
But, dude, you're flown in. You're put up. You're given the royal treatment. And you come out and you embarrass yourself. The judges that were at Pittsburgh will be there, in September.
Sure.
And there's a thing called redemption. And he can redeem himself if he shows up looking like he did a year ago. But he's just dug a hole for himself that's going to be extremely hard to dig out, to regain the confidence of those judges, and then also to regain the fans that signed off. I'm not the only one that was offended. Some people tried to come out and defend him. I saw Guy Cisternino come out and defend him. But it's really indefensible. Because he wasn't sick, and it was a situation where he didn't have to pose. We had 6 or 7 other great bodybuilders posing. Mm. He could have stepped on the sidelines, and he also, coming out there with the baseball cap on and with the height, with the shoes. I mean, I remember Bob Chick saying, "What is that? Like, can you imagine Arnold Schwarzenegger doing that?" Or let's just take it back. Let's just say it's Jay Cutler doing that. I mean, Phil Heath doing it. Shawn Rhoden shouldn't get a pass. That's not something we need to become accustomed to doing. I mean, if you know Rolly Winkler and he does it, you can kind of, you know Rolly Winkler's personality. It's like, okay, well, I kind of expect that from Rolly. I even expected it from Ronnie Coleman because it's a little bit different. But, you know, Shawn is being held to a higher standard. And you can't say it's unfair. No, it comes with the territory. How about let's sit back and watch Dorian Yates come out.
Right.
You know, and instead of Dorian being 300 pounds and watery and bloated, let's say Dorian Yates came out and he was 220.
Yeah.
He would never hear the end of it. And his excuse is, hey, you know, I started training for the Olympia in May, and, you know, I felt like I had to come out. And he's got the hat on. He's got the shoes on. Come on, man. We wouldn't give Dorian Yates a pass. We can't get you. We cannot get used to this type of stuff. It was a 30-second routine.
Right.
I don't think there was one pose that he actually hit. Go back and watch it. I mean, the front double bicep was like, was he high? Like, I could have sworn I was watching Homer Simpson high. Like, what am I looking at? I'm looking at the best in the world. You're Mr. Olympia. Compose yourself. Think. Talk, you know, get with your group, whatever. You got to do damage control by just being professional. I don't think Shawn did that as an amateur. Why are you going to do it now that you've worked so hard to build this platform and you just squander it away? Like, I put it this way. If I'm a promoter in the United States, I'm not hiring him. Yeah. On what grounds?
Right.
That's
what I was worrying about, Shawn. The guy won the Olympia. You would think most guys who win the Olympia will go on an Olympia tour the whole year. They guest pose every weekend, you know, up till 16 weeks out from the Olympia, and then they get ready, and they make a lot of money doing that. I mean, I'm assuming he, you know, no one's going to hire guest posings if the guy's not in shape. So that might have been
Shawn
a bad strategic move.
He's got a trainer. He has a manager. It's indefensible.
Yeah.
I mean, he should have been on the guest posing circuit representing, because that window was very small. And when that title's gone, ask Dexter. When it's gone, it's hard to get back.
Yeah.
You know, think about it. Dexter was Mr. Olympia 2008.
Mm-hmm.
How many years ago was that?
10 years, yeah. 11 years.
He's been chasing that title ever since. So it's very hard to get back. Samir Banu won it in 83, and he chased it into the 90s.
Yeah.
I remember standing up there with Samir Banu on the stage at the Arnold Classic in the 90s. So it's not a guarantee. And in this day and age, with the high cost of living, you know, he's a family, he's got kids. You got to think about that stuff. So you got to do the business. And if you think you're just, you know, you're good enough that you don't have to do the business, this is what we get: a bunch of people with a sour taste in their mouth. I'm a fan of Shawn. When Shawn turned pro, I was there to interview him at the North Americas, and I was there to help him get his very first contract with Generate. He came out to my house.
Right.
And I helped him get his first deal. So to see where he's come, it's amazing. We were all cheering for Shawn. When Shawn hit the stage at the Olympia last year, I was the first one to say, it's lights out. Phil's got too much ground to make up. I mean, Stevie Wonder could see that was going to happen. And then it happens, and now you have this platform, and your excuse of showing up looking like crap is, hey, I don't even start training until May. You know, I don't even start working out until May. You can take your time off. Keep your clothes on. I would have respected him more if he came out and said, ladies and gentlemen, you're about to see my competitors. I'm going to be competing with these guys coming up next. Look at the top five in the world. These are my challengers. Right. Unfortunately, I'm not posing tonight. I don't start training until this weekend. Yeah. Oh, and it's a holiday weekend, he said. It's Cinco de Mayo. Hey, don't start till Cinco de Mayo comes. He has a responsibility to say, look, Jim, I'm not doing this. I don't care what kind of money is in that envelope. I'm not ready, because a picture lasts forever.
Yeah.
And you can get beyond the comments, and you can go back in the gym, and you go against the naysayer. But Shawn's spending all of his time making excuses for why he looked like shit.
Yeah.
And that shouldn't be the case.
Shawn, let me ask you this. What is Phil Heath doing now? Is Phil Heath sitting at home licking his chops and saying, you know what,
No. Maybe
I want to do the show now?
No. Phil Heath was in Finland making money. Then he went over to the Body Power over in England this past weekend to make some more money. Phil is making money off of being Mr. Olympia, while Shawn is keeping his clothes on, doing absolutely.
But do you think that Phil Heath wants to do the Mr. Olympia this year?
You know what? Just seeing a guy like that, Shawn looked like that last year, as far as I was concerned, and I was there. I mean, he didn't look that much more impressive last year as he did this year. It's very deceptive, and we all know what it takes to get ready on contest day and what the sacrifices have to be. Let's give Phil credit. His first Olympia, he came out, he was fourth. Second one, he came out, he was second, and then he had a tear of 7 straight wins, and then he gets second again. He deserves a break. I mean, he didn't have to be chomping at the bit because Shawn looked the way he did. If he takes a year off, the same guys are going to be there next year.
Yeah, but do you think he's saying to himself, Shawn's vulnerable now, he smells blood, maybe I go back and win it back this year?
I think he felt that way last year, even with a bloated stomach. Phil didn't feel he lost. I mean, he knows Shawn's physique. To see Shawn where he's at right now, and to see Phil where he's at, Phil could jump in the game. We also said Nakai could jump in the game. But look, I think Phil's civilized right now, and I think he's smart enough to realize that his health is the most important thing, and the break is what's probably going to make him healthier and more competitive if he decides to come back a year from now. My thought was sail off into the sunset, but you know what? The landscape hasn't changed. We haven't seen anybody break out of the pack. I mean, we thought it was going to be Rolly Winkler, and then he showed up with a knee injury at the Arnold Classic, and he fell down. So he's still vulnerable. Dexter Jackson's probably chomping at the bit at 50-something years old.
Yeah, definitely.
But you know what? I mean, right now, the only one that's really doing the business, and this is categorically without question, is Brandon Curry.
Right.
I mean, he had youth on his side, so he's younger than these guys. Coming up behind all these guys, he's where they were, but he's got like 5 years to play with because he's younger than they are, and he's hitting that peak right now. Whereas we see, I can tell you, Shawn's on the downside, Dexter's on the downside. We might have seen the best of Rolly Winkler. And William Bonick, I think we can't get much more out of him because of his height. That's a height and stature situation with William Bonick. You know, he's going to have to find a way to refine what he has, not continue to build on what he has.
Right.
He's at that age where detail is what's going to keep him in that pack. I know I thought the same thing. Exercise wasn't going to make me better, but staying in shape, I can catch some of those bigger guys. That's where William Bonick needs to be at. So, and Big Rami, he doesn't know what he's doing. He doesn't know what he wants to compete. He's more confused than anything else.
Do you think if Rami has to qualify at the Tampa show against Dexter Jackson, do you think he actually makes it to the Olympia?
Well, he beat Dexter last year, and Rami didn't have an excuse, and Dexter didn't have an excuse when it was time on the Olympia stage. You know, like Vince Taylor, Father Time is catching up to Dexter. Dexter will never acknowledge Father Time because when you're in the throes of contest prep, you don't want to hear that stuff.
Right.
You think you're invincible, but you know, as a layperson watching, you can see the age factor in the thickening of the skin, the thickening of the waist, the absence of the hamstrings, the lack of wow factor. There's not a whole lot going on there. But Dexter in the right lineup can win. And right now, if you're Rami and you're dealing with a shoulder injury and some indecisiveness, Dexter can beat a guy like that because Dexter's all in, whereas Rami may have 1 foot in and 1 foot out.
Right. So in your estimation, let's say Shawn Rhoden's off. Who's the second guy in there? I mean, who do you think is the guy who could be Mr. Olympia this year if Rhoden doesn't come in?
I can't discount what Brandon Curry's doing. Look, he won the Arnold Classic. He beat William Bonick. He beat Cedric McMillan. He beat everybody that was there.
Mm-hmm.
That's the Olympia lineup without Shawn Rhoden. Shawn Rhoden was in the Arnold Classic. We have the Mr. Olympia lineup. There it is. Brandon Curry beats them all. Mm-hmm. So to Brandon Curry's credit, from one show to the next, we see the muscle starting to mature. We see that the time invested in Kuwait is paying off. We even see in his offseason here in May that he's hungry enough to continue training through it. He's not taking the time off like Shawn. So time off for some people works. We thought it was working really well for Kevin Lavroni, but Kevin's slow decline towards the end was probably due to all of that time off.
Yeah.
You have to do the business when you get older, especially. Look, Shawn's 43.
Yeah.
I mean, we're going to guess 43, 44. How many bodybuilders do we know at that age are getting better? You know? So even Phil has time on his side. If he sits this one out, he comes back at 42 years old next year, he may have a better opportunity to come back and make waves. I mean, look, for Phil, you give him the right midsection and he's Mr. Olympia. We're not even talking about Shawn Rhoden.
Is it? But let's say Phil doesn't do the Olympia this year, and Brandon Curry wins the Olympia. Doesn't that kind of give Brandon Curry momentum now that it's going to make it harder for Phil to beat? Wouldn't it be smarter for Phil, if he can come back this year, to strike while there's really no established guy yet? You know, where Rhoden is kind of a little vulnerable, and Phil still is being thought of as, you know, that seven-time Mr. Olympia?
We got to keep in mind that for two consecutive years following the Olympia, Phil Heath wound up in the hospital and had surgery, and major surgery, I might add. I mean, they talked about the surgery. So you keep doing what you do, expecting different results, and it just makes you stupid.
Hmm.
So who wants to wind up at the advanced age of 40 in the hospital for a third time trying to chase down this thing? So let your body heal. Take the time off. Sit back and watch what you miss. Watch what you love. And if it's enough to watch you win Brandon Curry, who never beat Phil Heath in head-to-head competition, Brandon Curry beat Shawn Rhoden, that might be enough incentive for Phil to then get out of the, you know, get off of his rocking chair and come back. But we know that it takes more than just looking at a weak lineup to motivate somebody. I mean, while it's weak in the month of May, it'll be strong in September.
It's going to be a strong Olympia.
Yeah.
No
they
doubt.
They always do the work when it's time, right?
Right. There's no definitive guy out there right now, I think, that's invincible. That's what makes it interesting, I think.
You're absolutely right. But while there's no definitive guys, Phil's got 7 Sandow trophies on his mantle. He knows what it looks like. He knows what it feels like. And look, even Lance Armstrong, you know, when he got hit with cancer, took some time off, he realized how important it felt to have that yellow jersey. Yeah. Sometimes time off gives you perspective of who you are and what you miss and why you do what you do. So Phil sitting in the audience might need that in order to come back in 2020. And guess what? He'll be dealing with the same people.
Although, then you have another addition, Flex Lewis, who announced in Pittsburgh also that he'd be entering the open division in 2020 as well.
Well, but he's also taking a year off, and I get that he's younger, but he's got all these other things going on. So it doesn't necessarily make you better taking a year off, and sometimes it gets even harder because you get civilized. You get used to making the excuse of not going balls to the walls, right? Not taking your foot off the gas. And Jay Cutler will tell you, the hardest thing was when he took that year off and tried to come back, even though he wound up in fourth, should have been sixth behind Rolly Winkler. The hardest thing after you make the publicity rounds and you're basking in the glow of your success, it's hard to go back and eat those meals and block everybody out. Especially like James got, you know, he's got the kid at home. He's doing well, I guess, with Yamamoto and all other things. Now you got to get out of your silk sheet bed and go back into the dungeon. Unless it's going to Kuwait, it's not that easy.
He's got his own dungeon over there in Boca Raton. Believe me, he doesn't have any problem going into the dungeon. Last question, Kai Greene. We discussed this, you know, ad nauseum. I talked to Dan Solomon about it on the air. It seems as though the IFBB wants this guy. We all want him in the show. And it just seems as though Kai is not responding. What do you think is going through Kai's head? Is he done? You think he'll never compete again?
No. I think he's done. Listen, I can't speak for Kai. His business is going good, which is great. Good for him. I mean, look, I remember when he was dead last in 2006 at the Shawn Ray Colorado Pro. Dead last with, like, nothing in his pocket.
Right.
Came from the back of the pack. He's like a Mike Tyson story, right?
Yeah.
The difference is Kai's creative mind allows him to do things that other bodybuilders just aren't creatively aware enough to do. We see Kai at Comic-Con.
Yeah.
You know, he's selling pictures. He's an artist. He's peddling shoes. And he's got his little e-books. I mean, he's doing all kinds of stuff. And that manifests itself with the creative mind to the degree that the single focus of winning contests just to get out of poverty is no longer there anymore.
He's not hungry, is what you're saying. Yeah.
The single mindset of, I have to be Mr. Olympia to have value, is not there. He looks at his social media and he's almost at 5 million followers. He has value. Right. He has relevance. He doesn't need the Sandow trophy like I used to feel to define who he is, to define the body of work that he's creating.
Right.
Because of all these other opportunities, the Mr. Olympia is just, it's just another ripple on the ocean for him right now. So me personally, if I'm him and I'm in his head, I'm like, that's the one thing I don't have. That's the one thing that made me who I was. This is it. I'm going to do it. And I would announce it and commit to it. He hasn't done that. And it seems like there's some conditions and things that have to align for him to do it. When you get into all of that minutia, you take your eye off of just being a bodybuilder. It's almost like a boxer. When Mike Tyson was boxing with Customato with Kevin Rooney, that was it. But as soon as he started getting out there and doing the Pepsi commercials and he bought the ranch out there in Ohio and the Lions and the cars and Robin Gibbons, you knew it was done. So Kai's got a lot of things going on. So we don't know that just because he's big now and he hasn't really stopped working out, that he's got the discipline and the mindset like Rocky going to Russia to get the title back. I don't think that's there anymore.
Yeah. But that's a very good analysis, I think, of Kai's mindset, because you're right. He's not hungry for it. He doesn't need it anymore. And sometimes when that eye of the tiger, so to speak, goes away, you know, it doesn't become as important. But it'll be an interesting Olympia lineup for sure, you know, especially with all these little side dramas going on. Everyone's got their own little drama, you know, and
And you know, David, there's also this space that you have to remember when you're in that type of training. It's not fun. Yeah. I mean, you don't have any friends. You're not able to travel. You're not able to do the things that he's been doing for like the last 3 years. Mm. And when you take all of that away, it's like taking you out of the real world and putting you behind bars.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like you getting shipped off to Kuwait or Iraq to war. Like you lose touch with reality, man. And that's a tough place to go. Kevin Lavrone and Flex Wheeler, you might want to interview them and ask them about what they had to give up to try to get it back. And Father Time waits for no one. And we saw, you know, like a shadow of what they were. So it's not, we can romanticize about it all we want, but the rivalry between Phil Heath and Kai Greene is gone. And the Kai Greene that we knew as a competitor, I think it would be very hard to resurrect.
Mm. Interesting. Well, Shawn, thank you so much. Congratulations on the Muscle Fitness Flex position. And we'll get you on the coming weeks to showcase and predict and update us on what's going on with the Olympia.
All right, I got one more announcement. So we are working hand in hand and very closely with the Olympia. Dan Solomon and Tamer El Gundy are putting on in Las Vegas the weekend of September the 12th to the 15th at the Orleans Arena and also at the Las Vegas Convention Center. The main sponsor, Wings of Strength, Jake Wood, has resurrected the opportunity to have a reunion award of champions that will include all the former Ms. Olympia winners and all of the Wings of Strength winners. So we've got about 3 Ms. Olympia champions. We're still trying to lock in on the deal. But outside of that, literally from the beginning to the end, we have everybody committed to this reunion celebration that'll take place at the Expo. I'm working very closely with Alina Popa, a former Wings of Strength champion. And we are contacting these ladies individually to try to have that reunion. And of course, we're also going to be inviting some iconic figures to come and witness this. You might have heard of somebody named Anya Langer back in the day.
Wow, yeah, that's great.
You might have heard of some other names like Sandra Blackie and Sharon Bruneau and Mario Celine. We're going to invite all the who's who of the women's bodybuilding world to try to come and witness and be a part of the Olympia weekend so the women bodybuilders, for their body of work, not only get recognized but also see what the future is for Wings of Strength, which is still going very strong. And they have shows throughout. They have one in August in Tampa, Florida, with Tim Gardner's show. They also have one coming up in Phoenix, the Rising Phoenix, which will be the week before the Olympia. Right. All of those ladies and the new ladies will get to hopefully meet and reunite with the former winners, including Iris Kyle, Linda Murray, Yaksani Orkin, Androla Blanchett, Juliette Bergman. These are girls that have all committed. Wow. I talked to Corey. I talked to Rachel. So this is happening in real time.
What about Corey Everson? Will she be there?
I talked to Corey. Yeah, I mean, we're just making sure that everybody is on the same page and everybody gets what they need in order to participate.
That's awesome. That's great news. Who came up with this idea?
Sorry?
Whose idea was this, Shawn?
So this is something, you know, Jake Wood and the Wings of Strength is the major sponsor of the Olympia weekend, and it's all about women bodybuilding with regards to Wings of Strength. So we thought there was no Wings of Strength without the Miss Olympia, right?
Yeah, of course.
And Miss Olympia's been off the landscape since 2014. Hmm. And these ladies have never been reunited in one place like Arnold Schwarzenegger did at the 25-year anniversary and the 30-year. We saw Joe Weider do it in 94, and we saw him do it again about 2010 or 2008, somewhere in that range. But the women kind of got lost in all of that. With Wings of Strength having such a strong footprint this year at the Olympia, we want to recognize where it all began. So I'm really working hard, along with Alina and Jake, to try to get Corey Everson, because that is the beginning.
Sure.
And obviously Iris Kyle, which was the end. And then we have now the birth of the Wings of Strength champion. So we're in communication with all the ladies right now, trying to put it all together. But that's going to be a reunion, one for the ages. I know you're a strong proponent for the women bodybuilding movement, along with Bill Dobbins, Brian Moss, all those people that work really hard to keep the women's movement alive are going to have this opportunity to meet some of these ladies that they didn't get a chance to know.
Yeah, well, it sounds great. I love it. I love new ideas. I think Dan is a fresh breath of fresh air in the Olympia arena, and I think that we're going to see some great stuff in the future. I think we're only getting started. So that, for me, is exciting as a fan and as a press and guy who covers the show. I always like to see new, fresh ideas. So, Shawn, hopefully you keep contributing to that. And like I said, we'll have you on in future episodes to break down the Olympia and do some predictions in the future.
All right, man. Check us out at Muscle and Fitness and Flex.
All right. And the guys, that'll take us to the end of another episode of Smack Talk with Shawn Ray. Stay tuned. We'll see you next week.
All right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, man. Appreciate it.